Welcome to my Painter's Anatomy playlist. The lumbricals are four deep intrinsic muscles of the palmar side of the hand. Now, if lumbrical reminds you of something, maybe ascaris lumbricoides, for instance, you're actually right, because lumbrical means worm-like. Because these muscles are very thin and elongated, someone thought they resembled worms. At least they didn't name it after food. But we can actually use this to our advantage, because thinking of a worm burrowing deep, you can actually remember that these are deep muscles and that they cross the hand, in that they originate on the palmar surface and insert dorsally. Personally, I like to think of the lumbricals as an in-between the interossei muscles, the palmar and dorsal interossei muscles. And if you've already watched my videos on interossei muscles, you will understand why I chose to talk about lumbricals afterwards. The action that both palmar and dorsal interossei muscles have in common is flexing the metacarpophalangeal joints while extending the proximal and distal interphalangeal joints. And that's exactly the primary action of the lumbricals, flexing the metacarpophalangeal joints while extending the proximal and distal interphalangeal joints. However, the lumbricals are weaker than the interossei. So, because they have a large number of muscle spindles in them, it's thought that perhaps they have more of a proprioceptive role, meaning that they are involved in the pinch movement, but more specifically in delicate and precise pinch movements. They are mostly involved in controlling the exact amount of force that will be applied, rather than by providing the force itself, which will be mostly afforded by the interossei. Likewise, the palmar interossei muscles are unipennate, they have one head each, while the dorsal interossei muscles are bipennate, they each have two heads. So, what's the middle ground here? Well, the lumbricals, the first and second lumbricals are unipennate, whereas the third and fourth lumbricals are bipennate. Yes, that's why I like to think of them as an in-between the palmar and dorsal interossei. However, they differ from the interossei in that they do not attach to any bone. They originate from a tendon and they insert on a tendon. They originate from the radial side of the tendons of the flexor digitorum profundus muscle and they insert on the radial lateral band of the extensor expansion of the tendon of the extensor digitorum muscle. So, they do not originate or insert on a bone. Furthermore, the palmar interossei muscles are supplied by the deep palmar arch, while the dorsal interossei muscles are supplied by the dorsal carpal arch. So, lumbricals are supplied by both. And there is also a contribution from the superficial palmar arch for the third and fourth lumbricals. But come on, the arteries from the superficial palmar arch are going to anastomose with the arteries of the deep palmar arch anyway to form the proper digital arteries. So it's basically the same thing. Thus, the deep palmar arch will send palmar metacarpal arteries, the dorsal carpal arch will send dorsal metacarpal arteries, which will branch into the dorsal digital arteries, and the superficial palmar arch will also send common palmar digital arteries to the third and fourth lumbricals. It's a bit more complicated, but if you can remember the interossei, You just need to think of the lumbar cause as the in-between, the palmar and dorsal ones. They are supplied by both palmar and dorsal anastomoses, and they are both unipennate and bipennate. The point at which they begin to differ a bit from the interossei muscles is in innervation. The third and fourth lumbar cords, like all the interossei, are innervated by the deep branch of the ulnar nerve. However, the first and second lumbar cords, like the tendon on which they originate, are innervated by the median nerve, despite the same roots, CH and T1. That is, at least, the most common presentation, because in 20% of people, you can have three lumbar cords innervated by the median nerve, and in another 20% of people, you can have three lumbar cords innervated by the ulnar nerve. Don't you just love anatomical variation? It really goes a long way, making each of us unique. And it also makes it so much easier to study and memorize things. But if you're going to go into that, then you remember that thing I told you about the first and second lumbar cords being unipennate and the third and fourth being bipennate? Well, technically, any of them can be either unipennate or bipennate. And you can also have accessory insertions into the tendon of the flexor digitorum superficialis. So, pick your choice. Do you want to keep that in mind or not? Anatomical variations do exist. Finally, we should talk about a deformity that has lumbar call in the name. The lumbar call plus finger is the paradoxical extension of the interphalangeal joints when attempting to make a fist, that is, when attempting to flex all the fingers. It happens when we have a detachment of the tendon of one of the fingers of the flexor digitorum profundus. See, since the lumbar calls originate from the tendon of the flexor digitorum profundus, what happens when the tendon loses the insertion on one of the fingers is that the lumbar call becomes the new insertion. See, if you lose the insertion, the only way for that specific bend of the tendon to transmit its strength into the finger is through the lumbar cord, which is connected both to it and to the finger. So, when you attempt to flex the fingers, when you flex the flexor digitorum profundus, what will happen in one of the fingers, the one that has been detached, is that it will mimic the action of the lumbar cord. Even though you are flexing your flexor digitorum profundus, it's acting like a lumbar cord because it's lost its original insertion and is now inserting posteriorly, so you can never actually flex the interphalangeal joints. But if you have no idea what tendons I'm talking about, maybe check my painted anatomy playlist, in which I have videos such as hand anatomy, or maybe see a completely different topic such as OBGYN. No surface anatomy videos on gynecology. Yet. I don't think YouTube would look very favorably on that. E, se você fala português, certifique-se de ver o meu canal em português. Thank you for watching all the way to the end, and I hope to see you on the next one.